So what do Robin Williams, Marilyn Monroe, and Billy Joel all have in common? They all have dual diagnosis. Robin Williams had depression and anxiety and an alcohol and cocaine addiction. Marilyn Monroe had schizophrenia and a bipolar disorder and an alcohol addiction. And Billy Joel had depression and an alcohol addiction.
Alrighty, so what is it? So co-occurring disorder is when you have both a mental health and a substance use condition or disorder. And then how common is it? So about 7.9 million people in the U.S. today have it. And then some vocab that you should know. So abstinent means not using any substances at the time. Addiction is a physical dependence on a substance of abuse. Substance abuse is a dependence on addictive or harmful substances. And then a treatment program is where you can seek help if you do have a mental health or treatment or need treatment. And then a treatment program, and a treatment program is where you can get treatment. And then dual diagnosis is similar to co-occur disorder. It's just basically a psychiatric disorder and then a substance use disorder.
So a really common philosophical question today is what came first, the chicken or the egg? And some people will say the chicken because they say that like you can't have the egg without the chicken hatching it. And some people say the egg came first because you can't have the chicken without the egg. And the same kind of goes for the co-occurring disorders, because nobody really knows if the mental disorder came first or if the substance abuse comes. And that's why it's so common, because it's really easy to get, but that's why it's also very hard to treat, because it differs from person to person what came first and which is more prevalent.
So our driving question is, how can we better prevent co-occurring conditions in people's lives?
And so some learning targets. Our first learning target is to inform people, so you guys, about co-occurring disorders, to find ways to prevent co-occurring disorders from happening in society today, and then to explain the effect of co-occurring disorders on people in our world.
There are three important concepts that you should be able to know. First, there's not a one-size-fits-all approach. Dealing with these types of issues is hard because everyone has a different background to their lives, so having similar treatment may be tough, but helping overall should slowly disappear the problem. Everyone will not heal the same because everyone has a different background, so not everyone will heal. Sorry. But that doesn't mean that they won't heal at all. And then our second important concept is that people should look for help, because if they don't look for help, then the problem can get worse. And by admitting, some people are scared to admit that they have a problem because it makes them look weak, but that doesn't mean that they're weak to have a problem. It makes them stronger to be able to admit to the problems that they have. And then our third important concept is that it's more prevalent than you think. As Faith had said, it's 7.9 million people have been affected, and that's just adults in the United States. And so there are many children that suffer from this as well, and other people around the world. And when I first started learning about this project, I didn't know what co-occurring disorders were. And I bet many of you don't know what co-occurring disorders were before this. But learning about co-occurring conditions can help other people.
So what we know about co-occurring conditions is that there's a lot of stigma and myths surrounding it, which need to be cleared up for us to fully understand it. Three really common myths that always come up are that it only affects adults. Only adults can get this, and a lot of people think that because a lot of the substances that people get addicted to, technically you can't use until you're of age. People also think that it's easily controllable or that they have it under control, which comes along with a lot of the substance abuses or mental illnesses, that they believe that they have it under control and they can control it and they don't need to go for help. Another myth is that only one part of it needs to stop. So if you're addicted to a substance, you only need to stop your addiction and not focus on the mental illness, and you'll be cured from your co-occurring disorder. But these aren't true. As we talked about earlier with the chicken and the egg, it's all interrelated. So a lot of people might turn to the substance abuses because of a traumatic childhood that they had, or they get the mental illness because of their dependency on the substance. It's not either or, so you can't just cure one. Because if you go and try to cure just the substance abuse, you're doing it because you're depressed. So you might might walk out of it sober, but then since you still have your depression, you're going to fall right back into the same cases and become addicted again. And it happens, like, vice versa, it works the other way. But it's not hopeless. It will take time to cure because, like Anna said, everybody's different, and it can be hard to dig to the root of the problem. But people do get help, and they get helped every day. It just takes time and patience.
So we have three interviews that we had taken, and our first one was Sadie Holland, and she was a worker at a Teen Challenge, and that's an organization that helps with co-occurring conditions. And with our interview with her, she talked about how everyone had an emotional background, and that is why that people turn to drugs and stuff. But that doesn't mean that the first part of co-occurring conditions is caused by depression or mental illness, but it does mean that that is the reason why they turn to drugs. The second interview that we had was with an anonymous 12th grader who went to Teen Challenge. She never had strong views against drugs. So when she first started, she just thought she was just gonna have fun kind of thing, but it turned into addiction. So then she ended up needing to go to Teen Challenge to find some help. And then our third interview was with Ms. Sholin. She's the counselor at Eastview High School. And she talked about how many students don't like to talk about their own problems. And if they go to her asking about these kind of conditions, they talk about how their friends do drugs or someone else. They don't ever talk about themselves. So our first takeaway is that co-occurring conditions happen at all ages, and that patients range in the organizations from 12 to 80. And for the organizations between 12 to 16, they don't really go to Teen Challenge, but they go to a different organization outside of that. But no matter the age, the co-occurring conditions does not discriminate. And our next takeaway is that people often seek justification for the problem. So when dealing with drugs, people like to say, like, oh, it's not that bad, other people are doing it, or it's like marijuana is a medical use, so it can help me as well. But people just want to justify it so they can feel the need that they can escape from their problems. Our last takeaway is from these interviews is that personal stories help others to be able to connect, and it's very effective to relate to personal stories. Since these interviews are, since one of these interviews was with a 12th grader, she talked about how when she was in treatment, it was very helpful when she had heard a different story from a girl that is her age, and so it helped her to connect and not feel alone.
So we conducted a survey that asked 9th, 12th, 11th, and 10th graders at Eastview High School kind of questions about co-occurring disorders. The questions were taken from the Minnesota State Survey, the PHQ-9, which is a depression questionnaire, and questions about demographics, and a question about bipolar disorder. So almost half of the 63 students that took the survey indicated a possible chance of developing or having a co-occurring disorder. So the first question was based off of the answers they gave. So the answers were not at all, several days, more than half the days, and nearly every day. And the question was, over the past 2 weeks, how often have you been bothered by having little interest or pleasure in things? And this one, 60% of Eastview students indicated signs of depression by answering more than half the days or nearly every day. And compared to the Minnesota survey, it's a little higher. 53.6% of Minnesota students indicated a sign of depression. And then the second question was, over the past 2 weeks, how often have you been bothered by feeling down, depressed, or hopeless? And the answers were the same. So 68% of Eastview students said more than half the days or nearly every day. And 45.6% of Minnesota students said that. So, and
was, has there ever been a period of time that you felt so good that others thought you were not your normal self? Or the opposite, have you ever felt so bad that others thought you were not your normal self? And the answers to this one were yes or no. It wasn't, not at all, several days and so on. So 60% of these two students said yes, which is an indication of bipolar disorder. And there was no data for the Minnesota survey because this question was not on there. And the question four was, I feel good about myself. And the answers for this one were strongly agree, agree, somewhat disagree, and strongly disagree. And 56% of Eastview students said somewhat agree, somewhat disagree, disagree, or strongly disagree. And 34.9% of Minnesota students said, gave those answers and indicated signs of depression or other self-esteem issue. And the fifth question was, I have a purpose in life. And 40% of Eastview students said they believed they did. And 40% of Eastview students said that they did not believe they had a purpose in life. And 24.6% of Minnesota students said they did. And they both indicated signs of depression. And the sixth question was, have you utilized any of the Eastview support resources? And the options that we gave were coach, teacher, school psychologist, counselor, or I have not used any of the Eastview support resources. And 53% of Eastview students had utilized the Eastview support resources. And obviously there was no data for the Minnesota survey. It's not all Minnesota students, but Eastview. And the seventh question was, how often do you consume alcohol? And the answers that they could choose from were, I have never consumed alcohol, I've tried it once or twice a year, once or twice a month, once or twice a week, or daily. And 24% of Eastview students said they consume it once or twice a month, once or twice a week, or daily. And 10.8% of the surveyed Minnesota students said that they use it more than once or twice a month, which indicates a possible future alcohol addiction. And the next question was, how often do you do drugs? And 27% of Eastview students said they did it more than once or twice a month. And 25.1% of Minnesota students said they did it more than once or twice a month. And by doing it more than once or twice a month, you do indicate a possible future drug addiction. And the ninth question was, what grade are you in? So 3% were in 9th grade, 9% were in 10th grade, 32% were in 11th grade, and 53%, the majority of our surveyed students, were in 12th grade. And there was no data for the Minnesota survey. And the 10th question was, what gender are you? 19% were male, 77% were female, and 3% preferred not to give their gender to us.
So, some steps that can be taken today are, first, to inform others about co-occurring disorders. So, after you've learned about it today, you can go and spread the information. Talk to people who you think may be at risk is the second one. So, if you think that somebody may be at risk for a co-occurring disorder, make sure to talk to them and encourage them to go and get help. The third one was, if you're curious, to just research more about co-occurring conditions and disorders. And then number four was to support those who show signs of co-occurring disorders. So you don't necessarily need to try and help them, you can just encourage them to go and get help. And then you need to be patient, empathetic, and understanding, because it does take time to fix and cure. And so you have to be patient.
So there are a few phone apps that you can like use to help you keep you accountable and make sure you're aware of what's going on.